Every student thinks that the best scores go to the best memorizers. And the more detail you know, the better score you get. And that's simply not true. Exams are now going to test knowing how your facts are used in patient care. In other words, you have to think like a doctor. How to approach thinking like a doctor involves multiple ideas that we've been using here. And in today's video, we're going to discuss how to approach learning when you know the diagnosis. And once you get to a diagnosis, the best way to frame it is presentation, pathophys, and natural history. If you're new here, hit subscribe. I'm posting videos every week teaching students how to learn medicine. In addition to my discussions, we're actually going to be interviewing former students who are going to talk about how this has been useful to them. We're going to be interviewing teachers who are going to talk about the process of going from a subject expert to being a medical educator, which involves using all the aspects of your knowledge without a specific subject orientation. I'm Dr. Philip Tisdall. I've been practicing for 30 to 40 years, and I've been teaching for over a decade. Having taught for so many years and having to repeat the material so many times, I finally just wrote it all out in a textbook. You're going to want to have this as a way of having a permanent copy to the discussions we're going to be having in all of these videos. Today's video, we're going to be talking about how to approach your patient once you've established a diagnosis. In previous videos, we've talked about how do you get to the diagnosis. We've talked about how a chief complaint leads to a differential diagnosis. And remember that differential diagnosis is not getting a shotgun and blasting a whole bunch of pellets hoping one of them will land as the diagnosis. It goes organ, family of diseases, subfamily of diseases, until finally you get enough subfamilies, you get to a specific diagnosis. Let's pick a good example. Let's take shortness of breath. Nice, tight discussion. Two organ systems, heart, lung. If it's heart, it's going to be the major family of left ventricular congestive heart failure. Well, in America, 80% of congestive heart failure will be ischemia, hypertension, valves. Okay, today's discussion. You heard a murmur. We're in valves. Well, you're still in subfamilies. Valves are going to be mitral valves or aortic valves. Even when you get to aortic valves, you've got stenosis and regurgitation. But once you get to aortic stenosis, now you've got a diagnosis, and you know it's going to be one of two types. It's going to be the congenital bicuspid valve, or it's going to be the old guy's calcification. So a specific diagnosis is you've got an 80-year-old with a clearly diagnosed aortic stenosis. It's going to be calcific. Now you have a diagnosis. What should you as a medical student say? How am I going to organize a specific diagnosis? And that's the purpose of today's video. Once you have a diagnosis, you're going to say to yourself, presentation, pathophysiology, natural history. You're going to sleep that and dream that, and it's going to become a way of thinking. Let's talk about where that came from. It comes from this idea that all of medicine is diagnosis and treatment. I mean, the second I point that out, you go, yeah, what else could it be? But let's break that down a little further. When I say diagnosis, I want you to think about the patient's symptoms, your physical exam, which is your signs, and then they're often not specific and sensitive enough to get to a diagnosis, the testing you're going to do to prove what you expect from the first two. So when I say diagnosis, I want you to actually use the term presentation because, you know, diagnosis brings up all sorts of medical history and all sorts of people's feelings. Presentation is a nice neutral term that says we're beginning the diagnostic process. And you're going to break it into symptoms, patient, signs, you, the physical exam, and testing, which is overwhelmingly lab and imaging. Okay, once you've got a diagnosis from that, now you have to flip your brain because now you're talking to your patient and you're going to sit in front of your patient. He's going to say, what happens to me? And of course, that's prognosis. And then are there things and complications to worry about? Yes, there are complications. And last but not least, is there anything we can do about it? And that's treatment. You notice I didn't say drugs. It might be surgery. Yes, it might be drugs. It might be watchful waiting. Take the nice neutral term, natural history. What happens if we do nothing? And that's going to be prognosis, complications, treatment. Okay, why do I use the term natural history? Because remember, when I say what happens if we do nothing, matters because it's your comparison for treatment. There's no treatment that doesn't have side effects. all treatments have bad effects at some point. You're only going to do a treatment if the risk-benefit ratio is better, which means you've got to know what happens if you do nothing. So natural history is two things. You've got to know what happens to compare it to your treatment effect, but you've also got to imagine that you're speaking to your patient. And this really pops up in really curious ways on the exam. It's really kind of funny. It took me a while to figure this out. But let's use this just as an example so you'll understand. Let's just say we have an 80-year-old guy who comes in with recurrent bladder infections, and ultrasound and physical exam show he's got a really big prostate. And you're going to feel really good about yourself. Got it. BPH obstruction infection. But the students tell me, I got that. I was ready to go. And you know what they asked me? What would you say this is comparable to? A duck, a ladder, a boat, or a toilet? And they said, I didn't even know what they were talking about. Because what they hadn't realized is you're talking to your patient and you have to explain their problem. So if you say, why do you get recurrent bladder infections with BPH? It's because a major way of controlling infections as a bladder is you urinate and keep emptying the bladder. The second you have a residue, it's prone to infection. So when you're explaining it to your average patient who reads at a level of grade 5, you have to do it in a way that works for that patient. So why is he getting bladder infection? Yeah, it's just like a blocked toilet you can't flush. And the second I point that out, you go, wow, that's actually really good. But when you're studying, you have to flip your brain and say, how would I explain that to my mom's best friend? Let's come back to our discussion. I have a diagnosis, presentation, pathophys, natural history. We've done presentation. We've talked about natural history. But both of those circles, they're going to overlay on pathophys. Good pathophys explains the presentation and explains the natural history. If you've got a pathophys that doesn't do that, then you need to go back and find a really good tight pathophys. Because let's just go back to our aortic stenosis. You know, you're going to say, okay, what are we going to do? I've got aortic stenosis. What happens to me? And the answer is, well, I've got to know how much obstruction you have. And we're right back to clinical medicine is built on a foundation of basic medical sciences. So the second I say describe flow, you're going to bring up, believe it or not, atherosclerosis, right? Because this is Puiseux's law and flow is proportional to R to the fourth. Well, it's the same applies to holes and valves as it does to atherosclerosis in arteries. So we know that at 70%, we start to see occlusion. So you know the first thing you need in aortic stenosis is the same rule of flow, right? Our old guy, his pathophys aortic stenosis. Do you have this tight picture of I've got dystrophic calcification that's closing off the orifice, and when that 3-centimeter aorta goes to 1 centimeter, I'm compromising flow, and now I'm going to get this long natural history of homeostasis to adaptation, which is going to be hypertrophy, to disease, which is going to be decompensation. And now we have to add in time, and obviously our solutions in this case is probably going to be mechanical just to open the valve, isn't it? But look how well I can predict symptoms, signs, and testing just from saying to myself, I've got a 3-centimeter hole that's going to calcify to 1 centimeter because of age-related degeneration. I can do most things off that. It's a good, tight pathophys. Every disease you come to, you can see what we're going to do, aren't we? Once we've gone through chief complaint and differential and we have a diagnosis, we're going to organize it by presentation, pathophys, natural history. When I say presentation, I want to know who walks in the door, what are my patient's symptoms, what am I looking for in my physical exam. That's driven by my differential. And once I have a diagnosis, what I'm looking for natural history. And then what are the ways I do that? Is a stethoscope useful once I have aortic stenosis? Not as good as ultrasound because I need to know how much occlusion I've got, don't I? Once we go over to treatment, what happens? And the answer is, well, this is the natural history of aortic stenosis, and it's going to be driven by the amount of occlusion. And are there complications? Well, you know, not a lot. It's not like we're flipping clocks like AFib. And then is there anything we can do? And the answer is, oh, for sure. We can treat symptoms with meds, but eventually we're going to have to slit the valve. Once we have a diagnosis, presentation, pathophysiology, natural history, and make sure you can easily explain your presentation and natural history because you've got a really good pathophys. I want to introduce another idea into this, and that's the idea of a directed physical exam or a directed history. Let's pick left ventricular congestive heart failure. Your patient has shortness of breath. You know that over the natural history, That's going to decompensate and the pressures are going to back up to the right side. If you've got shortness of breath and you've diagnosed it on physical with your S3 and you moved apical impulse and the crackles in your lung, got it, perfect congestive left-sided failure, your directed physical is now going to say, do I have right-sided failure? So in other words, you realize starting with one pathophys and knowing complications in natural history tells you I'm now specifically looking for to say present or not. So if left backs up into right, now I know on history, I'm going to ask about edema. And I know on my directed physical exam, I'm going to look for JVD and pitting edema in the feet. Once you have a diagnosis, now we're talking about this idea of a directed history and a directed physical exam. It means you're going to talk about positives and negatives. It's a really powerful term for saying, do I really have a good working pathophysiology? Natural history. It's an old term from back when we had very little treatments, which means what happens if I do nothing? Because every treatment brings its own complications. Your treatment has to have more benefit than risk, which means you've got to know what happens if I just watch the disease. Prognosis drives treatment. Complications is a different idea. Complications is some diseases carry with them actually odd risks. So for example, if you say atrial fibrillation, atria only kick in 10% of your cardiac output. For most people, atrial fibrillation is not going to be a performance cardiac output problem. The complication is we've violated Virchow's coagulation rules because now we don't have good flow and we're going to form friggin' mural thrombi. So it turns out the major problem with atrial fibrillation is not that you can't complete a marathon. It's going to be that you're going to form clots and flip them. And those clots are going to flip to two common areas, right? They're going to go in the brain for a stroke, and they're going to go to the SMA and infarct your bowel. So your major consideration in AFib is going to be, can I revert this to normal sinus rhythm, which solves our problem of flow, or do I have to anticoagulate my patient? So some diseases, actually, the complications are more important than the disease. For some diseases, the complications naturally explain what follows from the disease processes. So when you say complications, you're always going to ask yourself, in the natural history, what do I have to look for? So when I say acute pancreatitis, you have to be able to do pseudocyst. That's just something to build in. Sometimes it's a big feature, sometimes it's a small feature. It's something you're always going to look for because you have to talk to your patient about it. So that's figure 1.1, the universe of medicine, diagnosis and treatment. Diagnosis, we break into presentation of symptoms, signs, and testing. Natural history, we're talking to our patient. What happens to me, prognosis? What do we look for in addition, complications? And is there anything we can do about a treatment? And they are both built on that foundation of pathophys. Once you have that, you recognize all of my diagnoses are going to be organized that way. You're now going to look for things to say, was it helpful there or not? You know, so when I say to you, I've got chest pain, if you think it's angina from ischemic myocardium, is the physical exam helpful? Because you've done presentation as symptoms, signs, and testing, you will actually ask yourself that question. Because the point is, physical exam is not helpful for angina. That's why we do troponins and EKGs. So organizing this disciplined approach and filling in all the gaps and knowing you have to talk to your patient, I promise you, your studying will be more effective and it'll last longer. If this video helped you, be sure to turn your notifications on. Each week, I'm going to be posting videos on how you can more effectively study and how you'll perform better on your exams. And if you haven't seen it yet, go see the antecedent video on chief complaints and differential diagnosis. See you next time.